कहां से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना, शहीदों की बातें वो गुजरा जमाना। 57 की जंग में फिरंगी खिलाफ बुलंजब किया था सभी ने आवाज, आजादी गुनाह है बताया गया था और हजारों को फांसी चढ़ाया गया था। सजा कुछ ने पाई समंदर के पार, समीरामीज में फिर होके वो सवार, वतन के लिए चल पड़ा था दीवाना। कहां से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना।
Beyond the high seas and up above the shallow waves lies a piece of land, locked in time, enmeshed with memories. The time itself narrates the stories in silence, written on the walls.
They fought against the British, they fought for the freedom, and they have been confined in this solitary cell, and they suffered all the tortures.
The soil is wet even today. Somewhere hidden under the grass are the footprints of those who once walked, lived and died here. The narratives of their uprising lives on like a soul of an eternal flame.
They wanted to make a jail in such a pattern so that these convicts in each cells cannot have communication to each other.
It's an everlasting story written and preserved within these walls, which housed in flesh and blood those who fought for our freedom.
मैंने देखा कि यहाँ की मिट्टी उठाते हैं, रोते हैं, पीपल के पेड़ के चबूतरे के चारों तरफ बैठते हैं, रोते हैं, आंसू से रोते हैं, बहुत ज़्यादा भावुक हो जाते हैं।
The story of this historical building runs close and parallel with the establishment of the Andamans and Nicobar Islands. First as a penal colony and eventually the territory of the Union. For long, these islands remained inhabited with the indigenous tribes and thought of as formidable to set foot for any kind of settlement.
The empire was expanding and the British were always on the lookout for outposts to safeguard their sea lanes. And to develop them, they had the convict labor which they were using to develop these places. You know very well, they have done it in the colonies, in the United States, in Australia, in New Zealand, in many other places. So the British were looking after these islands as a kind of an outpost where their ships can take shelter in times of storms.
Andamans and Nicobars are two different group of islands. And Nicobar was known to travelers, explorers, colonials, adventurers, and so on and so forth. It was known to all of them because that was in the ancient sea route. Even today, it is one of the busiest sea route that leads to Malacca Strait. Okay. So Nicobar was occupied by many European countries, European people like the French, the Portuguese. They came as adventurers, explorers. Then the colonials were Austrians, the Dutch, Danish East India Company, they occupied. Moravians, they came as to convert Christianity. But Andaman was untouched. Andaman was actually kind of, you can say, isolated and it was not occupied. It was only the indigenous tribal people who lived here.
It was the late 18th century when the British East India Company, on a spree to expand, explored Indian seas, in particular the Bay of Bengal. Marine surveyor Archibald Blair was the first to take the voyage to Andaman Islands in December 1788, leading to the establishment of the first British colony in the Indian Seas. The first settlement came up in Chatham Islands off South Andamans. The settlement flourished soon, with native Indians brought in here as convicts as well as labourers. But by 1796, the islands were vacated after the spread of unknown diseases.
East India Company वालों का ध्यान यहाँ अंडमान पर जब पड़ा तो करीब कई उससे पहले क्या था कि काफ़ी लोग यहाँ से जब भी गुजरते थे, कोई जहाज़ी या कोई दूसरे लोग गुजरते थे तो उन्हें दूर दूर से देखते थे और अंडमान के बारे में बड़ी मतलब वेग सी और बिल्कुल सही बातें नहीं मतलब गलत गलत जानकारियाँ किताबों में उस ज़माने में रहती थी.
दैट वॉज अ पीरियड ऑफ लॉर्ड कॉर्नवालिस हु डिसाइडेड दैट द आइलैंड्स शुड बी ऑक्युपाइड एंड हैव अ स्मॉल सेटलमेंट हियर एंड दैट वॉज द टाइम व्हेन आर्चिबाल्ड ब्लेयर The marine surveyor was sent here 1788-89 to survey these islands. He selected an island, today we call it Chatham Island. It was known as Mark Island also. And the settlement starts there. But that was for a very short while because that settlement shifted from South Andamans to North Andamans, where the mortality rate increased, people were dying, and once the in charge of the settlement also died, they abandoned the settlement, they abolished and they left these islands. That was in the year 1796. And then for 62 years, nobody comes here to Andamans.
As the English ships left the island, it remained deserted and unoccupied for next 60 years. Then came the Great Mutiny of 1857. The very uprising which shook the foundations of British Empire. A small mutiny in the British Army rapidly spread as a major rebellion against the company rule. But the great uprising was crushed, and what followed was a large-scale massacre and persecution of those who had raised the flag of revolt. Cut the very cords of the brave heart of the first war of independence from motherland. The British adopted a dreaded concept of penal colony, something they had so very effectively used in England.
उस वक्त में इतने ज़्यादा लोगों को, इतने ज़्यादा क्रांतिकारियों को, देशभक्तों को अरेस्ट किया जाने लगा कि अब अंग्रेज़ों के सामने एक बड़ी समस्या थी कि इनको रखा कहाँ जाए क्योंकि मुख्य भूमि के जो जेल थे वो ऑलरेडी बहुत भरे हुए थे, ओवर क्राउडेड थे, तो वो एक सही जगह तलाश रहे थे कि जहाँ पे इनको ऐसी एक सज़ा, एक ऐसे एक जीवन दिया जाए जहाँ पर इनके जीवन से सबक लेकर दूसरे लोग फ्रीडम स्ट्रगल में जाने से घबराए.
द ग्रेट म्यूटनी और द फर्स्ट वॉर ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस एज वी बिलीव इट, वी कॉल इट द फर्स्ट वॉर ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ 1857, दैट अगेन Decides the Britishers decide to occupy these islands and establish a penal colony under the punishment term called Kalapani. And from 10th March 1858, the first batch of 200 freedom fighters land here and the islands are occupied. And then gradually the war of independence or the struggle for independence never subsides. The Britishers are never able to totally subside that. And whatever the movement happens there in the country, they are all sent to Andamans under the Kalapani punishment.
10 March 1858 को पहला जो जत्था था 200 स्वतंत्रता सेनानियों का वो उनके ऑफिसर्स भी थे बाकी और SS सेमीरामीज स्टीम ब्रिग शिप हुआ करता था उस जमाने का सेमीरामीज उस जहाज़ में उनको अंडमान लाया गया. अथाह समंदर पहुंचा जो जहाज, सुनाई पड़ी होगी बच्चों की आवाज, नवाजा था माँ बाप ने भी दुआ से, कह कुछ न पाया वो बच्चों की माँ से, रवाना हुआ बेड़ियों में बंधा था, ना जाने क्या मुकद्दर में उसके लिखा था, बसाने चला अंडमा का वीराना, कहाँ से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना।
Away from the homes, in unfamiliar setting, the freedom fighters at first brave the elements, wilderness and diseases.
तो आप उस जमाने का सोचिए जब पूरे अंडमान में आदिम जनजाति रहते थे और बड़े मतलब ये भी थे, मतलब लोगों को नए लोगों को मार देते थे, उनको अपने जिनको उनको लगता था कि वो बाहरी है। तो ऐसे समय में जब पूरी 12 महीने बारिश होती, इतनी बारिश होती थी, कीड़े मकौड़े जंगल न रहे और कोई भी मतलब बंदोबस्त, इनके रहने के लिए कोई बंदोबस्त नहीं था और बिना किसी प्रायर अरेंजमेंट के इसी तरह से इन लोगों को अंडमान भेज दिया उन्होंने।
Not far from today's island headquarters of Port Blair, the very idea behind this jail in Viper Island was to break the spirit and very idea of revolution among the freedom fighters. Solitude was the chief weapon of the colonizers.
See, they were not ordinary convicts, of course, but they were a mixture of all, because they were sepoys who were working for the companies initial period, and they were farmers, they were educated people like Maulana Fazle Haq Hairabadi, all those. So there was a creamy layer as well as the other ordinary, everyone who revolted against or raised their voice against the British atrocities.
Soon after they arrived at the shores of Andamans, the inmates were forced into labor, made to clear the jungle in Chatham Island, Ross Island and also at the Phoenix Bay. It's documented that the task of clearing the jungles, the harshest and most dangerous of the work detail, was specially given to the mutineers. Even though it was an open jail, the rules at Viper were strict. Inmates were often tied with iron chains at the pretext of breaking the rules set by the British officers.
Chain gang is a very cruel punishment, where 6 to 7 prisoners are tied together with a chain round their waist and made to work. So if one person collapses, the others will have to carry on work with that burden also. And the chains would cut through their waist, through their ankles, through their hands, and they are festering and they get infected. So the rate of mortality was very high in the jails. This is a very torturous punishment.
It was called the Viper Island Chain Gang Jail, where convicts were put in chains together, 7 together in a chain. And that was compulsory. Initially it was a longer period, then it reduced to 1 month. Earlier it was 6 months compulsory stay in Viper.
Viper was chosen mainly because, you know, escape is much more difficult from it. It is inside the harbor, it is isolated, it can be well guarded, and to escape from there the convicts will have to come all the way towards Chatham and then head for the open sea. So the first jail came up in Viper Island. It was a massive jail. You can see the ruins even today.
These are the only remains of the Viper jail. The first ever jail constructed in Andaman Islands in 1867. Etched on these walls are the stories of pain, struggle, and defiance of a first ever batch of freedom fighters. One of them was Sher Ali Afridi. Any historical narrative of these islands will remain incomplete without the story of that great Pathan from Northwest Frontier Province of undivided India. A sepoy of Punjab Mounted Police, Sher Ali was transported to the penal colony after he was convicted of murder in a family dispute. Soon after arriving here, the conditions of inmates and atrocities by the British officers enraged him. 5 years into the establishment of Viper Island, then Viceroy Lord Mayo arrived at the islands amid fanfare by the British on 8 February 1872. The same evening, as Lord Mayo decided to see Mount Harriet and enjoy the splendid sunset, Sher Ali seized the occasion to avenge the injustice inflicted upon his countrymen. He emerged from the dark and attacked him. The stab wounds were enough to kill Mayo, sending fright among the colonizers.
Hey Lord, His Excellency Chief Commissioner of Port Blair presides over the court.
Sher Ali, you're charged with a treacherous crime of murdering a viceroy, Lord Mayo. Do you confess to your crime?
Yes, I do. मुझे इस काम के लिए खुदा ने हुक्म दिया था।
Who all were there, your partners in this crime?
No one. मेरा शरीक कोई आदमी नहीं, मेरा शरीक खुदा है।
Sher Ali, you're hereby pronounced guilty and sentenced to death. Your execution shall be held here, at the Viper Island.
आबाद की वतन के परिस्तों ने चाथम न खुशियां थी ना था कोई मातम नारायण था पहला शहीद अंडमा का निरंजन फजल हक बहादुर ये भीमा सभी ने वतन के लिए जिंदगी दी इसी सरजमी के लिए रोशनी दी न पानी था ना था रहने का ठिकाना कहां से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना
In the following years, more and more freedom fighters, revolutionaries and intellectuals were sent to Andaman Islands, by now which had gained an infamous acronym, Kala Pani. It was then the British decided to build a new fortress of miseries, the cellular jail.
As the freedom struggle increased on the mainland India, and as more and more prisoners were being brought to the Andamans, they thought of building the cellular jail, for which they already had the plans, because similar jails exist in many of the British colonies all over the world. In fact, there are similar jails in India itself. I visited Rajahmundry Central Jail, which is exactly like the cellular jail. It was built much earlier. And I've seen old Melbourne jail in Melbourne, which is exactly the same as the cellular jail.
ये सेलुलर जेल बनाने का ध्यान उनको तभी आया जब 1890 में एक जेल कमेटी ने अंडमान विजिट किया और फिर उनके सिफारिश पर 1893 से सेलुलर जेल का काम शुरू हुआ यहाँ पर और जैसे जैसे जेल बनती गई ऐसा नहीं कि पूरी जेल एक साथ बन के तैयार हुई और उसके बाद यहाँ पे फ्रीडम फाइटर्स और दूसरे कॉन्विक्ट्स को यहाँ रखा गया ऐसा नहीं जेल जैसे जैसे कोठरियाँ एक एक जैसे मान लीजिए इसके 7 भुजाएँ हुआ करती थी उस ज़माने में तो 7 एक भुजा अगर कंप्लीट हुई कि एक ब्लॉक कंप्लीट हुआ तो उसमें जितनी कोठरियाँ उनके पास अवेलेबल थी तो उसमें उन्होंने फ्रीडम फाइटर्स को और बाकी कॉन्विक्ट्स को रखना शुरू किया
Taking 10 long years to complete, the construction started in 1896. Also known as Indian Bastille, The jail acquired its name over the design of individual cells for solitary confinement of the prisoners. This structure was in years to become one of the darkest chapters of the colonial rule. A bastion of untold torture and agony.
The model for cellular jail has come from the Pentonville prison in London. They were, of course, sending them to colonies was basically for economic reasons, very cheap to maintain, and the infrastructure will be developed without much cost. And later on, you can develop into a beautiful city or a place where they can settle other kinds of people, like you have seen in Australia.
After almost 39 years, another jail comes up known as the cellular jail, which is today the National Memorial. And that cellular jail again is flooded with the freedom fighters of the revolutionary movement, which starts from 1905 later part. And freedom fighters of the first batch were sent to the cellular jail in 1909. Alipur bomb case, Maniktala or conspiracy case, and so on and so forth, which continued till the end, till 1938.
Rajahmundry had dormitories and bigger rooms and one wing for solitary confinement. But the same central watchtower, same kind of radiating wings, which is known as the panopticon principle. The panopticon principle was the brainchild of a man called Jeremy Bentham. Bentham has designed this kind of jails purely because it is cheaper to keep surveillance on all the prisons at the same time. You have a central watchtower from which very few sentries can keep watch on all the prisoners. And you can see from the cellular jail, the cells are open with a grating and everywhere you have grills. And from the central watchtower, you can keep watch on all the prisoners.
The inmates, many of whom were intellectuals and highly well-read revolutionaries, were convicted by the British under sedition for charges as frivolous as writing an article highlighting injustice by the imperial rulers.
ये वो पीरियड था जब रिवॉल्यूशनरी एक्टिविटीज़ जो थी, जो क्रांतिकारी गतिविधियाँ बहुत बढ़ने लगी थी, और उनको लगने लगा कि एक ऐसी जेल होनी चाहिए जी जहाँ पर जो लोग रहते हैं, जो अंडमान में जो रहेंगे, वो भी आपस में बिल्कुल मिलजुल ना सके. तो यही वजह थी कि उन्होंने बहुत ढंग से, बहुत सोच के इसको बनाया, ताकि ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा फ्रीडम फाइटर पर उनको उनकी सोच से ही प्रॉब्लम थी. वो नहीं चाहते थे कि उनकी सोच जो है वो अपनी सोच से दूसरों को प्रेरित करे.
द प्रिजनर्स टू बी सेंट टू द पेनल कॉलोनी आर नॉट ऑर्डिनरी कॉन्विक्ट्स. They are intellectuals. They are freedom fighters of a very, very hardcore, in the sense they are committed revolutionaries. They are bent upon getting independence for India. And these are people who can't be broken down by ordinary punishment like flogging or putting them on the oil mill, things like that. Solitary confinement, it's believed, is the easiest way to break the spirit of a person.
Even today, these names talk to us, tells us the stories, their stories.
जहाज पर लदे तीन चार दिन के मुश्किल सफर के बाद हमें जेल की पहली झलक दिखाई पड़ती. बेड़ियों में जकड़े हम सिर्फ जहाज को टापू की तरफ जाते देखते, और जेटी पर उतरने के बाद हम सब जेल की तरफ चलना शुरू करते. मानो जैसे वो लोहे की सलाखों वाला दरवाजा सिर्फ हमारा ही इंतजार कर रहा हो. उस दरवाजे के अंदर सिर्फ अंधेरा था और थी तन्हाई, सिर्फ तन्हाई.
They walked in proudly, holding their head high. They walked in chanting, they walk through these lanes, passing this legendary tree. Today, a repository of endless tales and the times this place has witnessed.
जो फ्रीडम फाइटर्स, जो रेवोल्यूशनरीज, जो क्रांतिकारी जो अरेस्ट हुए, उन्होंने एक नया नाम उनको मिला, पॉलिटिकल प्रिजनर्स, राजनीतिक बंदी. तो ऐसे में जितने सेलुलर जेल में आए लाए गए उस जमाने में, वो ज़्यादातर राजनीतिक बंदी थे, चाहे वो स्वराज्य पेपर से जुड़े उनके एडिटर हो, चाहे अलीपुर कंस्पिरेसी केस, नासिक कंस्पिरेसी केस, गदर मूवमेंट से जुड़े बहुत लोगों को अंडमान भेजा गया, इसके बाद में और भी मार्शल लॉ प्रिजनर्स, और बीच में कुछ टाइम वक्त के लिए सेलुलर जेल को बंद कर दिया था उन्होंने फॉर रिसीविंग पॉलिटिकल प्रिजनर्स, राजनीतिक बंदियों के लिए. लेकिन 1932 में फिर खोला उन्होंने, फिर बहुत सारे लाहौर कंस्पिरेसी केस से जुड़े, काकोरी केस से जुड़े, और बहुत सारे नाम, हर केस को उन्होंने अलग अलग नाम दिया था, और उनसे जुड़े कई सारे बंदियों को अंडमान, उन्होंने राजनीतिक बंदियों को अंडमान भेजा.
दीज आर एक्चुअली इंटेलेक्चुअल्स. Only thing is, they thought of gaining independence through armed struggle. And they studied how the armed struggles took place in other parts of the world. So some of them got training in things like bomb making, weapons making, or raiding a police station and stealing the arms from there, or robbing a bank to get funds for carrying on revolutionary activities. So these are the kind of revolutionaries who were brought here. So that's why you have the names like Lahore Conspiracy, Nashik Conspiracy, Khulna Conspiracy, Alipur Bomb Case, Maniktala Bomb Case, Chittagong Armory Raid, things like that. So these are all young firebrand revolutionaries. They are not like other convicts who were sent to the jail. And these are people who can't be easily broken down. Their spirit can't be broken down easily. And they resisted to whatever punishments that were meted out to them in the cellular jail.
The colonizers had modeled the cellular jail with a stark precision to meet their sinister purpose of draining out the freedom fighters. Three-storied in height, seven wings radiated from a central watchtower. The architecture of this massive jail building was conceptualized on the lines of Pennsylvania system, a method also called separate system, where each inmate was barracked in separate confinement to completely isolate them from the other. Each cell measured 13.5 feet by 7 feet, lined up along a 4 feet wide corridor, running the whole length of every wing. Only thing they could hear was either cries of inmates or the sound of a closing door.
Well, these cells housed people in flesh and blood who fought for the freedom of the country. That thought cannot escape your mind, whatever purpose it has been used earlier. But you know that Parindra Kumar Ghosh was there in this cell, Savarkar was there in this cell, somebody was there in this cell. They fought against the British, they fought for the freedom, and they have been confined in this solitary cell. And they suffered all the tortures.
They wanted to make a jail in such a pattern so that these convicts in each cells cannot have communication to each other. Okay, now when they are in the work shed, there they have guards, they have tandils, and supervision is there. But when they are in the cell, it is very difficult to control them. So it was decided to construct the jail in such a manner that each wing have the back facing the front of the other one. And the cells were such that they cannot be opened from inside, and they cannot talk to each other next to each other also.
बाहर जाने का कोई व्यवस्था नहीं था. अगर उनको शौच के लिए बाहर जाना है, नेचर्स कॉल के लिए बाहर जाना है, तो वो 3 टाइम फिक्स हुआ करता था, उनको बाहर निकाला जाता था. उस, लेकिन अगर उस निश्चित समय से के बाद भी उनको जाना तो उनको वो पाबंदी थी। अब ऐसा जीवन जहाँ पर आपके नेचर्स कॉल पर आपके शौच पर भी अगर पाबंदी लगा ली तो फिर वो जीवन क्या है, अब बताइए। और जहाँ पर आप जहाँ पर आपको बिल्कुल ऐसे आपके शरीर को ही नहीं मानसिक रूप से भी आपको मतलब तोड़ा जाए, मतलब आपको इसके इसके अंदर रखने का मतलब ही हुआ करता था कि आपकी आत्मा को कुचल दे।
These wings were connected by a central watchtower by wooden platforms. Today, only three of the seven wings stand. Three wings were destroyed due to elements and the bombings by Japanese in World War II, and a solitary wall of a fourth wing stands today.
Locking system है वो इस तरह सख्त बनाया कि ये बिल्कुल अगर आप चाबी भी दे दो अंदर किसी बंदी को, किसी फ्रीडम फाइटर को, तो वो जब तक उसको कोई तीसरा मदद ना करे वो बिल्कुल कोई वो खोल भी नहीं पाएगा, कोई दूसरा आके मदद ना करे ले अपनी चाबी से, क्योंकि ताला जो है उनकी पहुंच से काफ़ी दूर हुआ करता था। और फिर उसके बाद उन्होंने जो जो लकड़ी का ब्रिज के साथ, लकड़ी के ब्रिज के साथ जो कनेक्ट किया भुजा और सेंट्रल टावर को, वो इसलिए बनाया उन्होंने क्योंकि मान लीजिए अगर किसी एक ब्लॉक में, उनकी सोच ऐसी थी कि अगर किसी एक ब्लॉक में कोई कोई विद्रोह होता है, कोई और बात होती है, कोई असंतोष पनपता है, तो वो चीज़ वो बात जो है वो दूसरे भुजा तक ना पहुँचे, तो उसको उस वुडन ब्रिज को अगर वही डिस्कनेक्ट कर दे तो वो जहाँ पे जो लोग हैं वहीं रह जाएंगे, वो दूसरे दूसरे जो भुजा में जो लोग रहते हैं, जो फ्रीडम फाइटर्स हैं, जो देशभक्त हैं, उन तक वो बात नहीं पहुँचेगी।
This jail was also a telling tale of instruments of torture used against the patriots. From flogging chained inmates on this triangular frame to backbreaking forced labor at oil mills. To choir pounding and even flattening the hills, each space in these islands speaks about endless torture. A specific daily quota was assigned to each inmate. If they failed to complete the task in specified time, punishment awaited, which aimed at breaking their psyche. The inmate was ordered to forego his sleep unless the task was complete.
The oil mill is a very, you can say, horrifying torture instrument. When the prisoner is yoked to it and made to go round and round like a bullock, within a short time he'll become dizzy and collapse. So that is a very common instrument. There's nothing fictionalized about it. Flogging is very common. I have seen the same kind of flogging stand in Melbourne jail also. But the pity is, flogging was stopped in most of the jails, whereas it was continued in cellular jail till it was closed down.
Cellular jail ki kal kotriyan aur inki deewarein bahut kuch bolti hai, bahut kuch, bahut dard, bahut vyatha, bahut kuch abhi bhi iski kahani ko likhna baki bhi hai aur bahut kuch likha bhi gaya, bahut kuch likhna baki hai. Agar aap sach jano to freedom fighters ne jo ऑटोबायोग्राफीज लिखी है, अपनी आत्मकथाएं लिखी है, उनको पढ़िए। ये मानना पड़ेगा कि हमारे देशभक्तों को, जिन्होंने इतना कुछ होने के बाद भी अंग्रेज़ों ने बहुत कुछ कोशिश की कि उनकी आत्मा को कुचल दे, लेकिन ऐसा हुआ नहीं, तो वो उन्होंने इस मोटी दीवारों के बाद से, इस सलाखों के पीछे से भी उन्होंने अपनी आवाज़ें बाहर मुख्य भूमि तक पहुँचाई और पूरे भारतवर्ष में हंगामा खड़ा किया, उनकी आवाज़ें सुनी गई।
David Barry, an Irishman, was appointed as the jailer. He and his wingmen were the chief perpetrators of endless atrocities on Indian prisoners. Flip any memoir of this jail, the tales of Barry and his torture will be writ large. One of those memoirs was of Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, remembered today as Veer Savarkar. Savarkar spent 10 years in this jail. In his jail diary, he had mentioned a great deal about Jailer Berry.
His role was very typical. He was felt because his credentials, his biodata, you can say, about his life in London, his activities there, when he was arrested and sent to India. On the way, he jumps into the sea and reaches France. So all these details were there with Barry about his activities. And he was considered to be very dangerous. That is why they say he had the tag called D. He was considered most dangerous.
Savarkar's autobiography has extensive quotations, extensive areas where he talks about his life in the cellular jail. And from him we come to know about the names of the jailers, their behavior. For example, David Barry, the notorious chief warden or the jailer, is well known to Savarkar. They used to have intellectual discussions sometimes on the Irish question. But at the same time, Barry would punish Savarkar if he doesn't obey the rules. Barry would not hesitate to inflict corporal punishment.
हजारों को कैद कर यहाँ लाया गया था, अबरडीन में कितनों को मारा गया था, पुरी के महाराज भी आए यहाँ और आए वहां भी, मणिपुर से भी पहुंचे थे सेनानी, और सितम पर सितम जब बहुत बढ़ चला था, उसी वक्त शेर अली फांसी पे चढ़ा था, बड़ी मुश्किलों से मिला आबोदाना, कहां से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना।
Such was the torture and atrocities inflicted on the inmates, in particularly on the political prisoners, that many opted for gallows to escape from the living hell.
The records in the jail show there were many hangings. Hanging can be for attempting escape. Attempting escape is punishable by death. Committing murder again here, for whatever reasons, and trying to attack the jail officers. Some of the prisoners were so frustrated, they thought death by hanging is better than undergoing punishment. So the easiest way is to attack a jail warder or a jail officer, for which you'll be instantly sentenced to death. And many prisoners were happily going to the gallows. And it reached such a stage when an inquiry was ordered to find out why so many people are attacking jail officers and going to the gallows. So that was the situation.
In cellular jail, the isolation was absolute. Neither they could write letters to the families and loved ones back home, nor they could interact with their co-inmates. As per the Barry principle, even a simple conversation was held illegal. No communication of any kind was possible between prisoners, even in the same wing. But there were few who defied that principle.
He was a highly educated, qualified person. And he was very intelligent, intellect. And what he used to do, we only know that he had written a poem called a Kavita inside the cell where he was put in, called a Kamala. But it was not only that. Why and how the Britishers decided that he should be kept in and isolated for a longer period and he should not be allowed to meet anyone. The reason being that they did shuffle convicts from cell to cell, floor to floor, wing to wing, but whichever cell Savarkar was put in, he used to write something. on the walls and not something rot. He used to write history. What he wanted his countrymen, his fellow freedom fighters to know about the revolutions happening in different countries, he used to write those on the walls of all the cells, wherever he was shifting. And that became a headache. Like, where to put him? Because somebody else is going to go there in that cell, and he will read whatever message or lesson is imparted by Savarkar. So that was the time when the Britishers decide, the Barry, that okay, he should be kept in one isolated cell.
Even the harshest and sinister most punishments couldn't break the spirit of a freedom fighters. They were frequent rebellions against the tyranny of the jail officials. The first such major event was in the year 1911. It was a Punjabi inmate, Nand Gopal, who flagged off the resistance. Transported to Kalapani for 10 years for writing articles against the oppression by British in his weekly Swarajya, Nand Gopal refused to work on oil mill, calling it inhuman. The spark ignited by Nand Gopal began to simmer as many other inmates too refused to work on the mill. The strike had begun. As atrocities and even death of one inmate by force feeding didn't break the resolve of the freedom fighters, the British authorities relented and allowed them to work outside the jail premises. The inhuman conditions, however, continued, leading to a suicide by one inmate, Indu Bhushan, a year later in 1912. The narratives of atrocities in Cellular Jail somehow made it to the press. Leading articles were published in the journal Bengali of Calcutta and later in the major daily, The Tribune of Lahore. An inquiry was commissioned, but as expected, it ruled in the favor of perpetrators, Barry and other English officials. But the fire ignited by those inmates kept burning. It was also a long struggle ahead for the freedom fighters. What all happened in the years to follow is still frozen in time. Those who made it outside the jail jotted down the memories, collating each day, each moment of the life inside Cellular Jail.
ਅੰਡਮਾਨ ਵਿੱਚ ਡਾਕੂ ਨੇ ਤੀਨ ਵੱਡੇ ਸੀਸੀ ਮਰੇ ਤੇ ਬੈਰੀ ਪਛਾਣ ਤਿੰਨੇ ਰਹੇ ਖੂਨ ਨਿਚੋੜ ਕੇ
ਫੂਲੇਗਾ ਫਲੇਗਾ ਇੱਕ ਦਿਨ ਲੇਕਿਨ ਮਿਲੇਂਗੇ ਖਾਕ ਮੇ ਲਾਖੋ ਹਮਾਰੇ ਗੁਲ ਬਦਲ
ਪੇ ਖੁਸ਼ੀਓ ਮੇ ਆਪਣੀ ਹਮ ਪਰ ਆਂਸੂ ਬਹਾਤੇ ਜਾਣਾ ਸਯਾਦ ਨੇ ਹਮਾਰੇ ਚੁਨ ਚੁਨ ਕੇ ਫੁੱਲ ਤੋੜੇ ਵੀਰਾਨ ਇਸ ਸਮਨ ਮੇ ਅਬ ਗੁਲ ਕਰੀ ਜਾਂਦੇ ਜਾਣਾ
बेरहम बेतुकम शैतान तिन्ने
ये दिल में ठान लो अपने हिंद में जान बहले
सुनी परी इस कबर पर अब दिया जलाते जाना अब दिया जलाते जाना
And the major victory for inmates came in the decades of mid-30s when a long spell of hunger strike broke the back of British officials. The wheel of the tyranny was lifted. As the struggle for our independence picked pace, the plight of Indians in the cellular jail was aggressively pursued by the leaders in the mainland.
Those who went on strike, they are not ordinary convicts. I mean, these are the intellectuals, and they know their rights. Some of them have been lawyers, writers, editors. They know the condition in other jails. And so they wanted certain facilities, like in other jails, like I must get newspapers or books to read or should be able to write letters back home, should not be given too much of corporal punishment. They knew their rights. So when the authorities did not bow down to their demands, and by the time Satyagraha was already, you know, proving to be a successful weapon against the British, they chose to go on hunger strike.
देखिए स्ट्राइक तो नहीं यहाँ पे 1912 में भी हुई, लेकिन जो सबसे बड़ी जो स्ट्राइक थी जो फाइनली अंग्रेज़ों ने 1936-37 में जो हुई ज़्यादा, उससे पहले भी एक 1933 में भी हुए जो जहाँ पर 3 लोग शहीद हुए जब फोर्स हंगर स्ट्राइक थे, जब तीन देशभक्त जो थे हमारे शहीद हुए, महावीर सिंह जी, मोहित मित्रा जी और मन किशोर नामदास जी, ये तीनों उस ज़माने में उस फोर्स फीडिंग के दौरान शहीद हुए, जिनकी स्टैचू भी वीर सावरकर पार्क में सामने लगी हुई है। और इन्होंने अपनी आज़ादी अपने कुछ सुविधाओं के लिए लड़ाई लड़ी, अपनी आवाज़ उठाई, और अंग्रेज़ों ने उनकी बात मानने के बावजूद भी जब उन्होंने उनको वो सुविधाएं नहीं दी तो ये लड़ाई इतनी देर तक चली कि बाद में महात्मा गांधी और रविंद्रनाथ टैगोर को इसमें उनका टेलीग्राम आया, महात्मा गांधी की उन्होंने भेजा कि आप अपना अनशन जो है समाप्त कर लें, हम पूरा देश आपके साथ है, हम आपकी रिहाई के लिए कोशिश करेंगे। तो ऐसे में फिर उन्होंने देशभक्तों ने अपनी जो हंगर स्ट्राइक थी वो ख़त्म की थी।
The strike finally ended after Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore intervened and wrote to the inmates, assuring them everything that their brothers and sisters in the mainland could do. And finally, in the year 1938, the British government decided to close down the penal settlement, repatriating all the political prisoners of Cellular Jail to their respective states.
ये 1938 जनवरी में बताते हैं, जनवरी 17 या 18 जनवरी को आखिरी बैच यहाँ से उन्होंने अंडमान से भेजा, क्योंकि ये पीरियड वो था जब द्वितीय विश्व युद्ध सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर बिल्कुल शुरू होने को था, और अंग्रेज़ों को लगने भी लगा था कि अंडमान को अगर ये जो जापान और बाकी कंट्रीज़ जो है इस तरफ अगर साउथ ईस्ट एशिया की तरफ से बढ़ते हुए अंडमान की तरफ आएंगे तो वो इस पर उनके पास इतनी शक्ति नहीं थी कि वो अंडमान को बचा सके, और हिंदुस्तान में भी आज़ादी की लड़ाई बिल्कुल चरम सीमा पर थी और लोग अपना अधिकार के लिए आवाज़ उठा रहे थे।
Now again by the time you come to the 30s, war clouds were again gathering over Europe, becoming difficult to maintain, and sending the prisoners by ship here, looking after them. That could be one of the reasons, I think, for closing down or rather stopping the transportation. There were already prisoners here, not that, you know, it was totally shut down. But the political prisoners have all been transported back because there was a lot of support for them from the mainland. Gandhiji, Netaji, so many people, and they are very vociferous in their demands. So they thought it is better to stop transportation of prisoners, and whoever is here as political prisoner, Cellular Jail, they have been repatriated.
And 1939, of course, there is a change in the entire world history. The Second World War starts, and then Andaman is doomed because it is destined that the Japanese are going to occupy these islands. The British has evacuated these islands by 1942, Jan and Feb, early period of March also, and then the Japanese occupy these islands, and they stay here from 1942 to 45. And Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose comes in the year 1943. He hoists the national tricolor on 30th December in the Gymkhana ground, which is today known as the Netaji Stadium. There he declares that this is the first liberated soil of India.
32 years after independence, Cellular Jail came out of the shadows of its dark past. Declared as National Memorial on 11 February 1979, this grand structure is quartered with the reminders of countless sacrifice. the beacon keep burning here, inspiring the generations to come. And remembering every soul who walked in here to pave a way for our freedom.
देखिए सेलुलर जेल तो आज तो तीर्थ है, तीर्थ भूमि है, मुक्ति तीर्थ है। जो जो फ्रीडम फाइटर्स यहाँ से गए हैं, उन्होंने भी, उनके फैमिली मेम्बर्स जब यहाँ आते हैं तो वो कहते हैं इसको मुक्ति तीर्थ। और आज सेलुलर जेल दुख की जगह नहीं है, बल्कि सेलुलर जेल एक इंस्पिरेशन की जगह, ये फ्रीडम का मंदिर है, ये एक टेम्पल है फ्रीडम का, जहाँ पर हमको बहुत सारी प्रेरणाएं मिलती हैं यहाँ से। और यहाँ पर अगर जैसे अभी भी जो बुज़ुर्ग आते हैं, जो जवान आते हैं, जो टूरिस्ट आते हैं, युवा पीढ़ी से जो लोग नुमाइंदे आते हैं, वो सब यहाँ आकर यहाँ की बहुत, मैंने बहुतों को देखा है कई सालों से, मैं दशकों से, दो दशकों से ऊपर हो गए मुझे यहाँ पर, मैंने देखा कि यहाँ की मिट्टी उठाते हैं, रोते हैं, पीपल के पेड़ के चबूतरे के चारों तरफ बैठते हैं, रोते हैं, आंसू से रोते हैं, बहुत ज़्यादा भावुक हो जाते हैं।
I have seen people break down into tears. Maybe not the younger generation, those who have seen the freedom struggle. I have seen them cry. And the younger generation, they learn from it, because otherwise not much is taught in school books. But when they come and see it, you know that what a price we paid for our freedom. So that's why people feel that coming here is like a pilgrimage. Visiting the cellular jail, not like an architectural monument. I didn't get this feeling when I visited old Melbourne jail. It only showed the pictures of, in fact, in each cell there is a picture of a murderer or a gangster who occupied that cell. Like Ned Kelly, a notorious bank robber. That doesn't give you any feeling of patriotism or, you know, sympathy. Whereas here, every step you find, well, here is a place where someone fought for freedom struggle and was confined here. And it's because of him, we are breathing in a free India.
ज़ुबां पर शिकायत न कोई गिला था, वतन पे था जिंदा, वतन पे मिटा था। जो लाए गए थे यहाँ सन 58, उन्हीं खुशबुओं से बना ये मधुबन। शुरू फिर हुआ सिलसिला वो पुराना, कहाँ से शुरू हम करें ये फसाना। शहीदों की बातें वो गुजरा जमाना।